Okay, let's start with this webinar. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this technical webinar. Because in June 2016, we have announced a strategic partnership and integration together with Milestone, we would like to take this opportunity and inform you technically about this integration. But first, let's introduce ourselves. Roy Bant, who's sitting next to me, is a solution engineer who will explain and demonstrate about the Milestone part from this integration.
Good morning, everybody.
And then myself, my name is Mark Menkhorst, and I'm a technical support engineer at NEDAP Security Management, and I will explain the AEOS part. During this webinar, probably you have questions. Feel free to ask them via the question box. But because we have only 45 minutes, we will send you the answer by email personally after this webinar. But of course, Roy and I hope, of course, that all your questions are answered after this webinar. Okay, because not all of you know NEDAP yet, I will tell you something or some facts about this beautiful company. At the background, you see the NEDAP headquarters. And you will find the NEDAP headquarters in a small town in the east part of the Netherlands called Groenlo. NEDAP was founded in 1929, and today we have 770 employees. We are active in 73 countries worldwide, and we are listed on the stock exchange market since 1947. NEDAP counts 9 different market units. And one of them is security management, for which I work for. NEDAP Security Management is a major player in the security market, and we have experience with access control for more than 35 years. Okay, that about NEDAP. Now about our access control system, AEOS. I created a small video who will show you the AEOS, how the AEOS application is working. I'm afraid it will not be a blockbuster, but after this video, I think you will all understand the basics from our AEOS application. Okay, let's start the video. First, the login screen. As soon as you fill in or fill out the hostname from the AEOS server at the top, you are able to connect with the AEOS application, and it's possible to log in. After you logged in, and it's loaded, the dashboard will appear, and on the left bottom side you will see all the doors within your building. Let's switch to the person tab. On the right side you see the quick launch buttons where you can enroll a visitor, employee or vehicle. Well, let's create an employee in order to give him access to the door. Let's start with an employee you already know. Yeah, fill out the details from the employee. We select an identifier in order that the person is allowed or is able to identify himself at the door. And it looks like that my video stops. So I need to press play again. Where's my mouse? Yep, there it goes. I select the identifier. I fill out my card number, so I'm able to identify myself at the door. Then I need to select a profile, so I have get really access to that door, because inside that profile is defined where I'm allowed to go. After I hit the save button, this information is stored in the AEOS database and will be sent towards the controller, and as soon as it appears at the controller, it will store it locally. And as soon as I present my badge, you see that I have access and the door will open. On the right part, you see that apart from that the door went open, also an event is created. And when you take a look at the details, you see that my card number is read, the source, so I presented my card at the administration office, and you see that I presented an authorized badge and I get access. Okay, a small recap about what you just saw. At the top, you see the AEOS application server. This is a server where AEOS is installed. For example, the receptionist. For example, the receptionist can open the AEOS application via her web browser because AEOS is a web-based application. The only thing what you need to have is that you are able that your client PC is able to connect with the server. She will enter her personal the personal data and the authorization data from a person, for example, an employee. And after she saves it, it will be stored in the AEOS database and it will send over to the controller. There will it be stored locally. So in fact, when the controller loses the connection with the server, it's still able to check the authorization from a person who presents the badge, because locally all the information is there. In order to get access, the person will present his badge at the reader. The badge number will send towards the controller by the reader, and the authorization check is done. And as soon as the process is completed, the door will be opened or not, and an event is created. This was AEOS in a nutshell, and I hope you have get a better understanding about how our application works. And before we continue, let's have a look which versions from both applications you need so they can communicate with each other. First of all, the AEOS application server. The Milestone plugin is a standalone program, but because we had to make some changes at our AEOS application, the integration is supported from AEOS 3.2.2 and up. So when you're having an older version than 3.2.2, please update. Looking at the Milestone versions, we support almost every Milestone version except the XProtect Essential. And when I'm correct, this is because this version doesn't have a plugin SDK, right?
Yes, it lacks the support for NEDAP SDK.
And the same goes for the Husky M10.
Correct.
Then AEOS and Milestone. In the video, we saw that when a person presents his badge at a sensor or a reader, also an event is created. This event is created at the controller and sent towards the server. On the other side, we have our Milestone server, who have their Milestone XProtect Smart Client on the right side at the bottom. This Smart Client can connect with each camera configured inside the Milestone system, and you're able to create smart views with specific cameras to view live or recorded video. Of course, there is much more possible with the Smart Client, but Roy will demonstrate that later. Well, you have the access control system AEOS with the configured doors and the events at the left side, and on the right you have the video management system Milestone. So the only thing where we had to think about is a way to let these two systems interact with each other. And there the AEOS Milestone plugin was born. Okay, let's have a closer look to the Milestone plugin. As you can see, the socket interface and the SOAP web service are mentioned. Both services are part from the AEOS application. The socket interface is an interface who is active as soon as you start the AEOS application. And that has started up from the AEOS application, this interface will also start and opens a port 8035 where external systems, in this case Milestone, can connect with in order to receive events from AEOS or send commands towards AEOS. Oh yeah, over here you see the commands who can be sent to AEOS. As you can see, you see access control mode, provide access, lock and unlock. Once you press a button or one of these, then this command will be sent towards our towards the doors inside your building. In contrast to the socket interface, the SOAP web service must be activated in AEOS and makes it also possible for external systems to retrieve and manipulate data from AEOS. And this server is this service is running behind port 8443. Both servers are used by the Milestone plugin in order to get the events and commands towards both systems. The SOAP web service is used to send the cardholder info to the XProtect smart client, and the events and commands to AEOS will be handled by the socket interface. Then let's have a look at the following overview. So we understand what's needed to get both parts, the socket interface and the SOAP web server, activated and correctly licensed. Within AEOS, we know two license structure. One for our blue hardware, the blue license, and one for our classic hardware line. The socket interface is activated by default for both license structures, meaning you don't have to activate it somewhere else in AEOS. Just connect to port 8035 and the socket interface is available. For the blue license, it's not necessary to order a specific license, but when using classic, keep in mind that you need a system user for each system that connects. So when you install the Milestone plugin, for example, it requires one extra system user license when using the classic one. Then the SOAP web servers. The SOAP web servers is not activated by default and must be turned on at the end of the AEOS installation. If you want to activate it at a running installation, you simply stop AEOS and run the setup again to turn it on. Looking at the license, and you are using a blue license, afterwards in the system properties, who you will find in the AEOS application, you have to turn it on. And as you can see, it's property 44.15. When using a classic license, it's a license option which needs to be activated inside our license file. So then you need to order specific that option. Okay, that about license. Then something about the Milestone plugin installation. And now we know how you should prepare your AEOS installation. It's time to build the bridge between AEOS on the left and Milestone on the right. First of all, you can download the Milestone plugin from our website, and that's a product website where you need to be need to have an account for, but you can ask for an account over here. It's a pretty easy installation, because after you download it, you can start it and you're able to change the destination, and after you hit the installation or install button, the plugin will be installed. In effect, that's all. One small note, keep in mind that it's not possible to change the installation destination. Why is this? That is because Milestone defined that a plugin must be installed in the folder program files VDOOS MIP plugins, and the NEDAP directory is optional. So when you change it, Milestone is not able to find the plugin so it won't show up in the management client. So what I not want to hear is you on the phone asking me or telling me that you change it. No, I'm just kidding. But please don't change it and you not run into problems.
Can I add something to that? So the plugin needs to be installed on the Milestone server. It's a plugin that is installed on the Milestone server.
Then something about the configuration. The first thing what you need to do after you installed the Milestone plugin on the Milestone server, you have to restart your event server service. And when you do not do this, Milestone will again not find the installed AEOS plugin, will not find it. And after the restart, the plugin will be loaded into the Milestone event server, and it will show up in the Milestone management client. This is an overview from the Milestone management client. And on the left side, you see the access control folder. And please click with your right mouse button on the access control part in the middle to start this this configuration. Simply give it a name, whatever you want, and choose the plugin. And as you can see, only one is installed here, so you have the only one to choose. After you click next, as you may all remember what I explained before about socket interface and the SOAP web servers, you will find all of this information I just told you back at this screen. First, we configure the socket interface where you have to fill out a hostname from the server, so where the socket interface is running, and which port is used. Is this port changed? Please change it here as well. The socket interface is secured by username and by a username and a password, so that's why you have to fill it out here. As you can see, I use the default built-in administrator account from EOS. And yeah, basically for the SOAP web servers, it's exactly the same. As soon as the port is changed, please change it here as well. The last option is called enable debug info. This option will enable extra information within the MIP log file. When we go back over here, you are also able to open the MIP log file by hitting show MIP logs. inside this log, the communication between the AEOS plugin and the event server can be found. So when there is something wrong, please open this file to check what's wrong. And that it will also be the first question if you have if you run into troubles and you call me, what's in that file? Okay. When you click next, the Milestone plugin will make the connection with the credentials you just fill out, and will give you an overview about the doors, events, commands, states, etc., what the plugin has found at the AEOS application. So after you finish this configuration from the plugin, these parts can be used inside the Milestone system for further configuration. At the last step from the configuration, you are able to link the cameras inside the Milestone system to the doors from AEOS. And after you clicked finished, the configuration of the Milestone plugin is done. Okay, then something about the AEOS Milestone logging. After this, I will give the stage to Roy, and he will demonstrate what you will see when you link a camera to a door and what you can do with it. But I want first show you this because I think it's really important in a configuration. During the configuration from the plugin, you saw I used the administrator account for the socket interface in the SOAP web service. It's also possible to send commands to the doors configured in AEOS. For example, when you press here the unlock button, the door will be unlocked, so everybody can go in without presenting a door, until you give the command access control mode again, and persons need to present a badge again. Well, as a security manager, I can imagine that you would like to see in AEOS who performed this command. And now it comes. When you have only one Milestone user, you don't have this issue, but when you have more than one user at the moment, but when you have more than one user using Milestone, you are not able to distinguish one user from another, because every command performed in the Milestone smart client will be performed by the administrator. And as you can see in the lower screenshot at the username, you see the account I configured inside the plugin. And as you can see at the screen, you see that I, as an administrator, unlocked the standard door. But you don't see the real person. It's just the person inside the plugin. But of course, we thought about this and created an option to solve this. The option we created is called Operator Login Required. As you saw, it was not possible to activate this option during the installation from the plugin, but after you configure the Milestone plugin inside the management client, you are able to activate this option. With this option, you are able to make the distinction between the different users. After you activated this option, you will get an extra login screen when you start up the Milestone Smart Client. The first one is just to check if you have authorization to the Smart Client via a Milestone, and the second one is where you can fill out the credentials from your AEOS application account. And after you hit the connect button, the account is verified with the AEOS application. And now each command will be performed in Smart Client by the user you're logged in with. So as in this example, I created an AEOS user called Mark Menkost, and when I perform a command, the security management manager is able to see that I performed the command. And here again in AEOS, at the system users, you see the last one is my name. When I hit one of the command buttons, you will see it as Mark Menkost. And over here you see that I put the standard access point in lock mode. Okay, for me that was it. I hope you have seen that the AEOS Milestone plugin is very easy to install and to configure. But if you would like to read all the details again about the Milestone plugin, you can go to NEDAP.net and look for this document. Or, of course, you can contact one of our NEDAP offices. And I will give the stage to Roy now, and Roy will continue with the Milestone part so you can see all the advantages when both systems are linked.
Yep, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. This is Roy speaking from the NEDAP office.
I will demonstrate you what is required from the Milestone site regarding the setup and give you a demo about the smart client. So first, let's have a look at our management client. We quickly or briefly show you the licensing that you need from the Milestone site. In order to run the access control integration with NEDAP, of course you need the base license for XProtect and of course the hardware device licenses. In this case, you can see here the base license and of course the amount of camera licenses you have in the system. On top of that, to be able to use the access control system, you need to have the Milestone XProtect access base license added to the corporate base license, and of course you need the access control door licenses. So the amount of doors you add to the system counts as one license. If we scroll down, you can see underneath here we have one section that is called access control. And once the access control plugin from NEDAP is installed on the Milestone management server or event server, you can start creating a new access control connection, like just shown in the presentation, but this is where you really need to find it. So here you can see the access control plugin that is installed, and you can connect to the EOS system. The EOS system is already added, and here are the credentials Mark already told you about during his presentation, for the socket interface and also the SOAP interface, and if you want to use an operator-specific login to the access control system to get more detailed logins about the users. So once the configuration is done, and also once the configuration has been changed, maybe in the EOS system, you can also request for a refresh from the configuration. In this case, nothing has changed, so it will say there's no changes found. But if there's something changed, you can refresh the configuration, and it will be downloaded to the Milestone system as well. In this case, in this demo, we have a couple of doors, of course, integrated. In the tab next to the general settings, there's the doors and the associated cameras. You can see the license status. In this case, it's a demo license for 29 days. And of course, in reality, you will have an infinite license as you have purchased it. On the left side, you can see the doors. In this case, I have four doors, an administration office door, an exit door, an hallway door, and a main entrance door. And if I select one of these doors, you can see the associated camera with that door. In this case, it's a camera associated with the door, and you can choose to remove it or add a second or maybe a third camera to the door as well. Adding cameras to doors can be selected from the right-hand side. Here you see all the cameras configured in the Milestone system, and now you can say pull and drag and drop another camera to associate with this door. So in this case, I have two cameras associated with this door. And that, of course, might come in handy if you have cameras on both sides of a door, the internal camera and the external camera, so you can look at both sides of an access point. And, of course, the same goes for the other doors as well. The exit door has also a camera, the hallway has one camera, and the main entrance has also a camera, of course. Now, except from the doors and cameras, there's also, of course, access control events. And in the third tab, you can see the access control events. And on the left-hand side, you can see all the events that have been that are being sent from the EOS system to Milestone. And of course, the most important ones, and potentially EOS could send much, much more events, but at this moment there's been filtering taking place for the most important events. And here you can see, for instance, door closed, door being closed after being forced opened, and all these events are created by the EOS system. The third column is the source type, of course, door unit, intrusion detection, and of course, we also support the events from the intrusion part of EOS as well, not only the access control events. On the right-hand side, you can find the event categories, and those are typically particularly the milestone event categories. And the event categories we can use later on in the system to follow up on these events or create alarms within Milestone or create any rules or actually anything you want to do, any alarm you want to create. These event categories can be selected in later options as well. So let's have a look at one of the events. We have a door closed over here. In this case, this produces an event category warning in the system. But you can see warning is used for other events from access control systems as well. So if I want to make a specific event category for door closed within Milestone, I can also say create a user-defined category, and I will add, for instance, a door closed test. So in this case, we have a new event category, and I can assign it to this EOS event. Let me find it somewhere. Door closed test. So now I have the warning. So it will generate a warning and a door closed test in the Milestone system when the door closed is sent by the EOS system. So now I can pick up this this door closed test at a later stage during one of the events. So if I want to create an alarm on door closed, I can go create an alarm. Save the change, yes. Create a new alarm. Door closed. And here you can see the triggering event, access control event categories, and here's my door closed test. So now I can create an alarm based on the new user-defined event category I've created. Now I won't save this because I don't want an alarm on any time a door is closed, but this is just to give you an idea of what you can do with the event categories, how you can link the EOS events into the Milestone events. So back to the access control part. Next to the events, there's something what we call access request notification. And access request notification is something that is related to unauthorized badges. So once somebody presents a badge outside the time zone or to a reader where he does not have access to, Milestone is capable of firing a pop-up window with the live video and potentially audio connection for the operator to see who's in front of the door, who has badged a card to a reader where he doesn't have access to, so you can monitor that on real time. That's what we call the access request notification. And here you can determine what is inside that pop-up. So there's a few control buttons. So when the pop-up appears in the smart client, I have a button to provide access, to lock the doors, to put the system in access control mode, or to unlock the door permanently. And of course, there's also the camera, the live video, the speaker of that camera, and the microphone of that camera available to the operator once there is an access request notification. I will shortly show you what that would look like. So if I just manually fire an access control or access request notification, you can see how that looks like. So the access request notification looks like this. I will show it again. This is the pop-up. This is the live video. This is the options that I've selected to provide. And if I now want to provide access to a certain door, I can provide access to the door. You can see the LED becomes green, and then the system becomes red again, and the door is closed again. I can do that again. You can also see it on the map, potentially, if you have the map configured. You can see here the door opens for the door period, and then the door automatically is locked again, so the door is secure. Here you can see the audio controls. I can open up the audio to speak to the person who's in front of the door, and enable my microphone so the person at the door can also hear what I'm trying to say to him.
So that's the access request notification if somebody presents a badge that is not authorized at that moment or is outside of a time zone. So that's all about the access control notifications. Cardholders, this field is blank, and that's because the nice thing about the integration with EOS is that all the cardholder information and events are sent on the fly in real time to the Milestone systems. So we don't need to download and refresh all cardholders inside the EOS system. As soon as there's a new cardholder in the system, together with a picture, it will automatically be sent directly real time to the Milestone event server. So this is on the rear end or on the back end of Milestone, the configuration of Milestone. There's also some things that you could do. I just briefly shown you about alarms, how you could create alarms. In this case, I'm going to demonstrate you how the access request alarm works, the door forced alarm, and how an emergency lock would look like in our system. But you can also create rules based on access control events. You can see here I've created a couple of rules, and with the event, with the rule wizard inside Milestone, you can control the entire Milestone system based on access control events. So if we take a look, for instance, for at this access control user defined access control mode rule, you can see here what is set up. Perform an action when all doors are in control mode from the external events, and we put all the doors in external control mode. But if I want to add other events as well, or actions actually to this event, you can see all the settings you can do within Milestone to create this rule and extend this rule to do other things within Milestone as well based on the access control event. The other way around, I can also control EOS and put EOS in a certain state based on Milestone events. So if there's a recording failure or a camera failure, I can put, for instance, all doors on lock or provide access or show the access request notification. So I can control in both directions. Okay, so let's have a look at the front end, our smart client, because that eventually is the part that the operator tends to use. Let's start at the beginning. On the left-hand side in our live view, because we have a couple of tabs, there's live, playback, sequence explorer, alarm manager, and the access control and our system monitor. Our system monitor is the part that that you can use to monitor your system on health, but the operator would normally use the live mode to do the access control. I've created a few layouts here, and the first layout I have created is an access control monitor. You can hear audio is also supported. In this case, I've created a few of four cameras with the access control monitor. This is the live view from the administration office, the live view of the main entrance, and you can see here the last actions that door has presented. So this is all live. So when I present a badge, for instance, at the main entrance, let's present the badge at the main entrance. You can see I presented the badge, my name, authorized badge, doors opened, and the door is closed. If I take another badge, from Mark, for instance, you can see also the picture from Mark. You saw the door went open, and the door went closed as well. So this is a real-time access monitor. You can see actually who has entered the door at what time. And you also have, of course, the door controls inside here. So if I want to unlock a door, I can put the door into an unlock mode and the door stays open until I say, lock this door again. And you see the status of the doors at the real-time. Now again, I will present another badge. Oh, the door is in lock mode.
excuse me, I will set it to put it in access control mode.
Percent badge mark is entering the building at the main entrance, and when I click on it, it will immediately go to the playback tab, and you can see the moment that the badge was presented. Playback, forward, and you can see actually the badge presented. And if you want to make sure this person is the right badge holder presenting the badge, you can eventually zoom in, and you can see this is the card of Mark Mankhorst presented the badge. What I also can do is put a bookmark to it. I can put a bookmark like Mark presented badge, and then this moment is marked, and you can look for the bookmark later on. But I can also create a snapshot. So now a snapshot of this picture is stored on my system, or I can make a PDF to print out and to put it on the wall above my bed, just to look at it the whole day. So those are all options you have in the live video. It's really extensive what you can do with the live video. And this is just an instant playback mode while maintaining the live video on all other three cameras. This is what we call an access monitor, a view like this. And it's very easy to create a view like this. If you have this folder here, you can also go to the setup and you can create your own views. If you want to create your own view inside here, you can say, let's create a new view, in this case, one by one. I will call it demo view. And to add access control monitor, you can see all here, all the objects that you are able to enter into a view. You can enter the access control monitor, you can put in carousels, camera navigators, HTML pages. So potentially you could also put the AEOS web interface inside the smart client. You can put maps inside here. You can put many things inside our smart client. But let's just have a look at the door. You can put the exit door here. Automatically it shows with the related camera to it, because in the configuration you related this camera to this door. I press OK and I created a new view, one by one, with all the events on the right-hand side. So if I now present a badge to the exit door, here's the badge, here's the door opening, playback. It's easy as that. Okay, so that's how you can create a view. This is the access monitor pane. It's with the controls. There's also just normal views, what you normally have. This is what camera views within Milestone normally look like. But there's also something what we call, and that we support in all our smart clients, and that is the overlay buttons. In this case, you can create your own overlay buttons. So if you hover over with your mouse in a certain camera view, you can see here there are overlay buttons available for the door control. Now I can provide access to a door, you can see it, or I can put the door back in access control mode. But if I want to add other overlay buttons for other features as well, I can do that. So here's the section in the setup for overlay buttons. These are the options I have. I want to create another button for unlock, maybe for the main entrance. So let's put another button inside for the main entrance. I want to do the unlock. Unlock main entrance. I can make it as big as I want. I can put it anywhere I like. I can align it with other things as well. Let's put it here. Leave. And now when I hover over, there's this unlock button. I can press unlock, and now the doors are in unlock mode. Very easy. Put it back into provide access. Yeah, then I have to create a access mode, provide access mode as well, to put it back in access mode. Is this the access mode?
No, the other one, the access control.
Yeah, the access control mode.
put the system back in access control mode, and now I'm able to present badges again for the main entrance. The only difference is, with this field of view, you don't have the real-time alarm monitor on the right-hand side. So this is all live control. Let's go back to the monitor, because here are badges live monitored. So when I click on it, it will automatically go into the playback mode. Here you can see the bookmark I just created. That mark presented the badge. When you hover over it, it will automatically open up that box and you can play it back. But in this here, there's also a search button. And what happens is the smart client will jump automatically to the access control list. And now all access control events from Mark, all his events from the database are stored and presented here. But if I want to show only the last hour, you can see Mark has entered his badge only 3 times the last hour. And when I click on it, you will see it will automatically jump to the moment the badge was presented. Here you can see the badge was presented and the bookmark you can see as well. So this is how easy it is and how effective it is to connect access control events to video. And if you look at this, you can also link this and bookmark this again. So again, badge presented, and it is stored successfully. So this is how easy it is to find and retrieve a video. If I want to have the last 12 hours, or today, or all of them, the last 7 days, you can see all the events generated. On the right-hand side, you can also create an access control report. So if you want to show when Mark has presented his badge to the main entrance, then I can filter a main entrance, and then you only get the events of the main entrance. And I can create a report, save it somewhere on your local hard drive of the smart client, give it a name, create, and then a PDF is created. Now it's completed, and here are the details of that PDF. I can then open up the location where it is stored. So here's the access control report for today, March 8th. But I can also say open up, and this is the access control report just created with the snapshot from the camera when the badge was presented. If there's no video available, it won't show you the snapshot, but as soon as there's video available, it will also present you the snapshot of the report. Here you can see the report, March 8th, Mark main course, time and dates, and the entrance of the main entrance. So that's the access control report. So we have live, we have the access control tab, to filter and to search for access control events. In this case, if I want to filter on my own name, I can do that as well. I can filter on Roy, you can do it partially, you can put in the last name as well, and you can see how fast it will retrieve video and events at the same time. It's very fast and very easy. Now, this is all live and playback. Let's have a look at the SQL Explorer. You can also search for the bookmarks, but you can also search for video based on motion. There's a thing what we call smart search. And if we now drag and drop, let's reset it. And drag and drop a square around the reader, then you can see the moments a reader was badged and selected any way you like. This is what we call our sequence explorer with the smart search. So you very quickly can scan the door when somebody entered the door or badge was presented to a door. Now, if you see something happening, I saw somebody badged at this moment, I can pause it. I can immediately make an export of that video from that certain moment, and provide that export to the authorities or maybe to the management. So this is very fast and easy way to search, export, to save snapshots, and to print out the events. The same goes for the playback mode. In the playback mode, we can have a recording search as well. We can search for bookmarks. Let's see if we can find the bookmarks. Here you can see all the bookmarks that have been created for these cameras in this view. And when you set the auto preview to on and show the details, you get more information. And as soon as you hover over the event, it will automatically show you what happened during that event. If this is not what you're looking for, just pick the next. And you can see how fast and easy it will show you the video, if there's video present. And if you want, here's something happening, you can directly export that video file to an external device if you want. So this is how you can create exports, search for bookmarks, playback video. You can see how fast a video is playback and synchronized with the system. It's very fast, and you drag the timeline and you see all the cameras that have recorded footage. That is very fast and easy to use. Now, of course, there's also things that what we call alarms. Let's see how Milestone and AEOS handle alarms. There's something what we call, we have our alarm manager. This is the alarm manager. Here's all the alarms that have been progressed the past day. There's also a section with new alarms. Of course, there's no new alarm at this moment. But as soon as there's a new alarm, you can see the alarm coming in. So let's try to get an emergency lock. Emergency is locked. You can see there's a new alarm coming in. So if I select the new alarms, you can see the state of the alarm. You can see the map is flashing. You see the door is open because it's emergency alarm. And you also see on the top hand side there's a new alarm entered into the system. This alarm you can now either acknowledge from the map, or you can acknowledge it from the alarm line, but you can also have a view, a live view with alarms. So if we take a look at this section, for instance, there's a custom built view with the alarms in the map and the alarms as a line in the alarm management tab. As soon as you select one of the alarmed lines, you can also see it opens up the associated cameras and the playback of that moment. So if there's video footage available, it will automatically show you the moment of playback of that emergency alarm. Now, let's acknowledge that alarm. The alarm is acknowledged. It will now go from new to progress, and you see the new alarm is handled and put into progress, and if you want to close it, it will be removed from the progress, and it will be set to closed. And here are the closed alarms as an operator. So put the door back closed again. You can see here the emergency lock is now deactivated, and the door is closed. So now the system is in a normal state again. There are also manual events. You can also provide access to many doors at the same time. So if you want to lock down a facility and stop access to all doors, you can just create a rule. And here you can see that the system is locked down and all the doors are closed at the same time. The same goes, of course, for unlock all doors. You can also open all doors. You can see the doors are opened. And if you take a look at this, you can see all the doors are now opened. Like I said before, we have four doors. Of course, now there's one missing. So let me show you quickly how you can add a door. Simply go into Setup, select the map, and then the tools of the map will be opened. And here you can see Add Access Control Doors. I think the hallway is missing. So let's put the door in for the hallway. This is the door.
you can position it, you can drag, drop it. Let's make it a little bit bigger, maybe. Big door, like this. Put the text somewhere, and this is how you add a door to the map. This is Milestone, this is quick and easy way to do it. So we have seen the alarms, we have seen the maps, we've seen how to create a view, we have seen how to add a door to a map. There's also maybe a good thing to know that is we support also video walls. So if you want to open up a video wall, you can do that as well. To do that, you can see here the map of your entire system. You see here the video wall control. So if I now open up a second view, which is what we call our smart wall, so you have to think about this as a second monitor on the big screen somewhere. I can now drag and drop cameras to a system and present the camera to the system. But also, if you have events, you can also present the text. So if I have something like lock all doors and I activate it, the smart wall presents text, all doors are in lock. Or if I make an emergency, I can display text, emergency unlock. So that means yes, somebody has to take action, and after 5 seconds, the monitor wall will go back to its normal position again. So this is how you can use the access control and the smart wall. And if you want to have the maps into the wall, then you can do that as well. And then you can control access control from here as well. Back into access control mode. Acknowledge the alarm. So this is how you can do that. The last thing I want to show you, and that's maybe a good thing to know, is we also have our support for mobile devices. This is my Android device. And here you can see the Milestone mobile application. When I open up the Milestone mobile application and connect to my NEDAP X-Protect server, you can see all the cameras inside your system. In the mobile application, there is, in this case, 4 cameras. You can see the live view, and I can swipe through all the cameras. You can see that. And you can also playback, of course, with the streaming playback. On the top right or top left, you have the live, while this screen below is in playback mode. Sorry that the controls are in Dutch, but we have to put it into English. You can select time for playback, playback speed. Can adjust for playback, and here you can see how easy it is to operate from the mobile device. Now, the live view is not maybe that interesting and related to access control, but what is interesting is, of course, the alarms, because all the alarms that were handled by the alarm manager in your smart client, you can also manage them from your mobile device. So if an operator is doing his guard tour, he is able to receive the alarm and put it into closed, for instance, and manage it, and read the text for instructions, and evaluate the moment what happened on that camera in case of that event. So it's very easy for an operator to be mobile and to be able to use the access control system and receive the alarms from the access control system to his mobile device. So now I've put it to closed. And of course, there's also the actions list, because with the actions list, you can do all the things you've done with smart client from your mobile device as well. If you look at the map, you can see here all doors are in lock, but if I want to put all doors in unlock mode, unlock all doors, and here it goes, I will control from my mobile device all the doors. If I want to provide access control mode, I just select access control mode, press OK from the app, and all doors are in access control mode.
And if I want to open specific doors, I can do that as well. I just open up a specific door, and you can see here the administration office is opened. I will close this door as well. Access control mode, main entrance. Okay. So that's the mobile device. So you can use your mobile phone to trigger events to the access control system, like the access request notification. You can send it to a smart client from your mobile device as well, live view, and trigger the doors to open or to close as well. I can see now it's 11 o'clock. We have seen all the features and availability within the Milestone systems together with EOS, NEDAP EOS system. If there's any question about the integration from the EOS side or the Milestone side, don't hesitate to contact us or your local Milestone or NEDAP representative. And with that said, I would like to thank you all for your interest and for viewing. The presentation and the video will be available for later review as well. So if you want to play it back on a later stage, then you're welcome to do so. Thank you very much for attending from me, Roy, and Mark. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
See you or hear you next time at maybe the next webinar. Have a good day.